All right. So hello, everybody. Thank you for coming to our webinar. My name is James Polidori. I'm a program specialist with the Great Lakes Commission. And this is our webinar on approaches for advancing Great Lakes water infrastructure. The document was created by the Regional Blueprint Working Group and will be presented by the Great Lakes Commission. So before we get started, we'd like to get through some Zoom controls and logistics. So we ask that you please leave yourself muted during the meeting unless you're called on. And you can use the raise your hand feature to be called on for any questions or comments you may have. So select the mute button and stop the video to turn your camera and audio off. You can also submit additional questions and comments in writing using the Zoom chat box. If you would like, you can also enable closed caption by clicking the closed caption button. And finally, if you have any technical issues, you can send the GLC a question in the chat box. And if all else fails, you can log out and rejoin the webinar. And there's also the option of calling in if that doesn't work. We would first like to start off to say that the Great Lakes Commission acknowledges that our office is located on the ancestral, traditional, and contemporary lands of the Anishinaabe, including Odawa, Ojibwe, and Potawatomi, and Wyandot peoples. We acknowledge that the native peoples of this region have cared for and stewarded the Great Lakes for generations and continue to do so today. We encourage those attending our meeting today to learn more about historic and contemporary Indigenous groups in your jurisdiction. More information on your specific location is available at native-land.ca. That's the website shown on the screen there. And we are particularly interested in feedback from tribes, First Nations, and Métis on materials being discussed today. We would next like to acknowledge the Joyce Foundation for their generous support and funding for this project. The approaches for advancing Great Lakes water infrastructure blueprint would not be possible without the Joyce Foundation's support. So with that, I will turn it over to my colleague, Nicole.
Good morning, everyone, and thanks for joining us. I just want to do a quick check to make sure I've unmuted myself. I am the program manager at the Great Lakes Commission staff based here, as James mentioned, here in Ann Arbor. And I have had the privilege of facilitating this regional working group that got together really roughly back in August. And they've really spent some time talking with one another, getting to know one another, and thinking a lot about how we, with this especially now infusion of bipartisan infrastructure law investment, can identify approaches that are really leaning into this idea that we have to be mindful always of issues of equity and also climate resiliency as we're working within the Great Lakes. James is going to drop a link into the chat that those of you with an additional device may wish to access. What it is to a geographic information system based tool that's a quick flash of it there that we are using to hopefully provide an easy opportunity for people to provide feedback. The reason we're sharing it now is that if you'd like to get connected and potentially walk through it with us this morning, you'll be able to do that. But there's also a tab in the idea portal that does specifically identify who was part of this regional working group and is continuing to work with us, looking forward to receiving feedback that we hear from you today, and also that we receive through this online portal. James, we can advance to the next slide. So, as mentioned, we've been funded through the Joyce Foundation to really buckle down across the region on this work and think of these questions in the forefront of our mind as we're working through developing the draft document that is being shared with those of you that are connected with us today. And we really started with this idea of who must participate in discussions. And we're not looking at it only as the regional working group that was convened, but as we move forward as a broad Great Lakes community What voices need to be heard as we think about the significant infusion in the, on the U.S. side of federal dollars coming in to the Great Lakes Basin? And then we turn to what are those shared challenges? How can we think through what our states, the Great Lakes Commission is an interstate agency that works on behalf of the Great Lakes states and provinces. What challenges are they finding in administering funds through their state revolving funds and other opportunities within the states? And then, of course, I've already mentioned, we want to make sure that there's an umbrella over all of this, where we are mindful that approaches are going to move the needle forward for us as a region as we think about equity, and also to assure that we are being mindful of the changing climate that we are experiencing here, and thinking ahead and building resiliency into all of the actions we take with these federal dollars. So just a quick recap, we have been working on this project for about a year now. We're just short of a year. The regional working group began with a fairly intensive workshop to get to know one another and identify some common points of interest back in August of 2021. They have met virtually like this several times now. And we've also reached out to some partners that weren't able to commit to being on the working group, but we know have been heavily involved in this idea of understanding what our needs are in terms of water infrastructure in the region, and what it's going to take to, again, assure this equitable and climate resilient approach as we move forward into the future. The draft blueprint has been available on the GLC website. And I think in addition to the link that's in the chat, the sort of shortcut to get into the project's webpage on glc.org is glc.org/work/GLWI. So if you wanna quickly scribble that down, that's one way to get into some of these materials as well. So now we're seeking feedback from the public. James had made a couple of announcements through our Great Lakes Information Network. We're glad for everyone to be here today, and we want to listen. So we're going to just go through a little bit more, and then I'll be turning it back to James, and he'll walk you through high level what's in the blueprint, these approaches that the working group has identified. And we'd like to be able to, hopefully, as a group, there aren't that many of us connected today, be able to hear what it is that you see when we start sharing this information. So when we're thinking about water infrastructure here on the staff of the Great Lakes Commission and what we're working on with the regional working group, we're talking about services related to drinking water, wastewater, and stormwater. And also being mindful that these systems have historically been managed separately, and that one of the broad ideas that has been discussed by the regional working group is the connectivity between those systems and how we need to be in the future more mindful of that as we think about our new investments and new approaches. So we know that multiple studies have taken place trying to identify the needs in the Great Lakes Basin in terms of our water services. And those numbers can range from $179 billion to the Great Lakes Commission did some work back in 2017 that binationally, I think, put it at $241 billion. However you slice it, it's a big, big number, but we have been really delighted as a staff to see the US federal investment in infrastructure. When we started this project a year ago, of course, the bipartisan infrastructure law, or the Infrastructure Investment and Jobs Act, depending on which acronym you prefer to use, was not yet in place. And now that it's here, we're able to see that just in 2022 alone, our state revolving funds in the Great Lakes states are all receiving at least $100 million to distribute. And so the timing has become very appropriate for us to be working with the public, looking at approaches to assure that as these funds start to be distributed across the basin, that they're really going to the areas that need them the most, and following some of these approaches that, again, are getting at equitable distribution of funds and thinking about climate resiliency. So the last bit for me is this graphic that we had prepared to try to explain what it is we're trying to do with this project. And for a while, it seemed like it was infrastructure week every week in Washington, D.C., right? And then finally, things go very slow and then they go very fast and we have this tremendous infusion of funding. So what we're trying to do now is be at this point where we are still at the first upper left-hand side piece of this, where we're receiving input on our blueprint, and then want to make sure that once we have it, we're sharing it around the Great Lakes community and beyond, so that we can all agree that these are steps that need to be taken as we work together to advance infrastructure in the Great Lakes. So with that, I think James is going to show us the IDEA portal, that link that we had shared in the chat. And then he's going to walk us through at a high level each section of the blueprint. We've been, as a shorthand, calling it a blueprint because as we were working with the regional working group, it was understood that this issue is really complicated. And so you'll see as James works with you this morning on this, that we have this concept of layers that's built into the plan, and that is very intentional and hopefully effective, but we want to hear from you if there's better ways to do it. And so with that, I am going to hand it back over to James for a little bit of walkthrough of what we've been doing.
All right, thank you, Nicole. So this is our IDEA portal, and so this is a map to kind of showcase where everyone who's providing feedback on this blueprint is located within the Great Lakes region. So our hope is to populate this map with several different pins to show that we have, you know, diverse voices from across the basin contributing feedback to this blueprint. The next tab shows the working group, all the members who were involved in this working group, and the Great Lakes Commission staff that helped support this project. The third tab shows the actual text of the blueprint itself, and I will talk through each of these sections in more detail in just a moment here. And then finally, the last tab, which we encourage you to follow along throughout this presentation if you would like, is for you to provide feedback on each section of the blueprint. So you can first state your name, the organization you represent, where you're located, and then you can click next once you fill out this information, and it will take you through each section of the blueprint, and you can provide feedback through each of those sections. So with that, we can get into the layout of the actual blueprint. So the blueprint is laid out by four priority areas, and those are public health and safety, community engagement and trust building, equitable distribution of investments and benefits, and asset management and workforce development. Each priority area is separated into three layers: the framing layer, which focuses on state and regional agency support systems, and local planning and prioritization efforts informed by meaningful community input. The next layer is the financing layer, which deals with the funding and financing mechanisms overseen by the federal government and the states. The last layer is the finishing layer, relating to local governments, utilities, and communities that implement improvements with affected communities, assuring clear two-way communication of objectives and anticipated benefits. So with that, we would like to pause here and see if there is any initial feedback or questions on this approach, on the layout, on the IDEA portal. So feel free to raise your hand or put a question in the chat, and we will pause for just a moment here. All right. Well, if you think of any questions or comments on this, feel free to raise your hand or put it in the chat, and we will get back to it as we move through this presentation.
Hey, James, we did just get one question in the chat box.
Oh, yeah.
We have a question. Can you discuss how the blueprint addresses the Justice 40 platform? Maybe you or Nicole can tackle this one.
So we will actually get to that when we're moving through each of these priority areas. That is a focus area that we are going to address as we move through the presentation. So great question, and we will get to that in just a moment. So if that is it for now, we can move on to the first priority area, which is public health and safety. The working group discussed that public health and safety is a central purpose of federal and state funding for water infrastructure systems, whether through the supply of safe drinking water, the collection or treatment of sewage, or the management of stormwater. This deals with supplying clean and safe drinking water, prioritizing funding for lead service line removal, as well as combined sewer system construction, protecting source water from pollution, dealing with expanding support for green infrastructure and nature-based solutions to managing stormwater in the face of changing climatic conditions, as well as advancing source water protection efforts from PFAS chemicals, harmful algal blooms, and other emerging contaminants. This also deals with the one water approach from source to tap. Dealing with what Nicole had mentioned earlier is viewing each of these water systems as one big interconnected system. This deals with loosening restrictions on which projects can be funded by various funding streams to ensure that all infrastructure improvements are supported holistically and equitably to solve pressing issues. This may be done by integrating project planning and implementation across each sector of drinking water, wastewater, and stormwater issues. So we would like to hear any ideas on opportunities to improve or if anything is missing from this priority area. So again, we'll take a moment here and you can feel free to raise your hand or put a question in the chat dealing with public health and safety. Are you seeing any hands or chats, Hannah?
Nope, no more questions are coming in yet. So I think we're good to move on to the next one.
All right, thank you. So again, if you think of any questions or comments on public health and safety, feel free to pop it in the chat and we'll get back to it later. The next priority area is community engagement and trust building. So at its core, water infrastructure exists to address the needs of people. This priority area ensures that the needs of all people are met, especially those that have been historically excluded from the benefits of infrastructure investments or are experiencing disproportionate water stresses. The working group acknowledges that trust is an earned asset, and it is up to federal, state, and local governments to rebuild communities' trust where it has been lost. So like I said, water infrastructure should address the needs of all people, and it's up to agencies and governments to meaningfully include disadvantaged groups in planning processes and decision-making. And decision-making should be prioritized with a community rather than for communities. It also emphasizes creating a path to engage for historically excluded groups. This also deals with emphasizing compassionate assistance and affordability options and assuring billing transparency by utilities. Lastly is the concept of level of service, or that utilities can support staffing to meet people where they are and listen to where they want to be to make sure that they're thoroughly engaging with the community that they are serving. So again, I'd like to take a moment to pause if there are any opportunities to improve this section or if you feel that something is missing. So we'll take a moment here. Feel free to raise your hand or put a question in the chat. All right, Hannah, do you see anything?
Nope, I think you're good to move on.
All right. All right, so our third priority area is the equitable distribution of investments and benefits. The need for water infrastructure investment affects urban, rural, and suburban communities. This priority area focuses on approaches to ensure that federal and state funds are equitably distributed to assure tangible benefits to the basin citizens, regardless of their zip code. This deals with ensuring that the state revolving fund program functions in an equitable and accessible way. The state revolving fund, or the SRF program, has historically provided massive amounts of funding for water infrastructure systems. So it's important that the program is equitable and accessible to disadvantaged and historically excluded communities. It's also important to provide technical assistance to disadvantaged communities to ensure that they have access to the funding source through the SRF program. It's also important to improve efforts to locate communities in need by making service area data available to see where disadvantaged communities are actually located within the utility service area. It also prioritizes that all SRF dollars are spent utilizing additional subsidies, including grants and principal forgiveness aimed at disadvantaged communities to make the program more accessible. And finally, this emphasizes state efforts to support the Justice 40 initiative, in which the Biden administration aims to provide 40% of certain federal investments, including clean and wastewater infrastructure, to disadvantaged communities. So again, we would like to pause if there are any opportunities to improve or if something is missing.
I'm not seeing any questions coming through.
All right. Thanks, Hannah. Yep. So with that, we will move to our fourth and final priority area, which is asset management and workforce development. Water professionals maintain myriad pumps, pipes, plants, and basins, despite much of the expansive water infrastructure system being buried and out of sight. Asset management is viewed as a holistic program to plan for the future and to develop the next generation of water professionals. This deals with ensuring that the skilled workers involved in maintaining water infrastructure systems are replaced as they age and retire. This is straining the key assets involved in the water infrastructure systems, and it's important to make sure that we are training the next generation of water workers. It's also important to ensure that capital, operation and maintenance, and human capital costs are evaluated to plan for long-term investments. That deals with this concept of asset management. It's important to prioritize data aggregation and sharing among utilities, agencies, and the communities they represent. The work group also emphasizes supporting training programs to increase minority and women representation, especially in the communities being served by the utility. It's important to diversify the staff as well as utility boards, as well as creating resident advisory councils and neighborhood ambassador programs. And finally, the working group emphasizes the importance of leveraging funding to sustain fiscal resources or growing financial resources over time, namely through the municipal bond market to ensure the sustainability of the financial resources for the utility. So again, I would like to pause if there are any ideas on opportunities to improve, or if you believe that something is missing, please raise your hand or put a question in the chat.
James, we did get one question from Olivia. What are some specific examples of training programs the GLC is looking to support?
I can pass that question on to Nicole, since she will actually be talking about some of this in just a moment.
So it's a great question, and this priority area of the draft is really interesting to me as I've listened to the working group, and that they're recognizing the importance of assuring that we have the next generation of the water workforce ready to go as we look across the basin and see that we need to start planning for some succession in a lot of our water utilities, as people that started out in this world as environmental regulations and improvements became of a job in the 70s and beyond, are now getting ready to retire. And so we're seeing certainly some of the associations like American AWWA and others are looking at helping utilities plan for that. But we also know that some of our larger systems around the Great Lakes have been doing some really interesting things in terms of working with neighborhoods and in trying to create paths to employment for members of the community that maybe didn't know or understand that working for the water utility could actually be a good paying job. But the group definitely is recognizing that as they're assembled, they're maybe not working directly in these areas. And so it's something where we're looking for people like you that are connected today and others that are providing feedback to share with us examples that you're aware of this type of work, so that we can share that back with the working group and consider lifting up some of those successful efforts, which is actually a question that's a perfect segue into the other thing you will find on the idea portal. But I want to just check. We've got a fairly long comment, but I don't think it's a question. But thank you, Sanjeev, for all the great resources that you're sharing within the chat. So I do want to also note, because I did receive a private message, that we didn't want this webinar to be something that you had homework in advance of. But at the same time, I think what we're also maybe observing or hearing a little bit from some of you is that it's hard to provide us feedback right now if you haven't looked at the draft. So I do want to share that I dropped into the chat a link again into that website that gets you to our project page within glc.org. You can click on the draft blueprint button there and get a PDF. You can also access the blueprint in its entirety through the idea portal. So please do take a look. We had hoped to sort of do a two-prong approach with this, where we give you this high-level overview of what's in it, and you can give us some gut reaction feedback on things today, and we're glad for what we have heard. But the online portal is another avenue for you to take a close look at what the working group has put together and share those ideas for improvement, including things that might be missing or areas that are maybe unclear and in need some additional text. We are trying to keep it fairly trim. It's just over 5 pages of text right now, so it's not that long of a read, and that was very purposeful because we do want people to read it, knowing that our audience of decision makers that are at, whether it's the federal, state, or local level, maybe don't have time in their schedule to read a 20, 30, 40 page report. And so we're trying to keep it pretty light, but still be reflective of the good ideas and approaches that need to happen around the basin. The other thing we're looking for, recognizing that as our regional working group had got going with this work, there's lots of other efforts, both nationwide in the US and even in our region, that have been identifying what needs to happen in order to move the needle on our water infrastructure. And what we wanted to do as we started to move along with this is to differentiate our list of approaches by pulling in some of the success stories from around the region where we know approaches are already happening, right? Good things are happening. They've just really needed more money. And now that more money is starting to be on the horizon, rather than having the blueprint simply be a list of what federal, state, and local partners should be doing, we want to also really illustrate the how. How are partners around the Great Lakes Basin actually doing some of these approaches already, so that we can, as a broad Great Lakes community, take some of those examples and actually replicate them or scale them up in other areas? Or if you're looking at something a large system has accomplished, maybe you scale it down, right, to what a smaller system can look at it doing for their community. So we've been looking for these, and it's been a little interesting as we've both hit up our regional work group members and then also other partners. They haven't been coming to the surface. And so we're really hoping for those of you that dig into the idea portal, or frankly, just send us an email if you want to talk. If you're aware of some work that's happening around the basin at whatever level, whether it's within a community action organization, specifically into water utilities, federal, state, local, we want to hear about it, because if they're actually taking the here's what you should do and doing it successfully, then that's news that could be shared. And we would be very happy to see some of those examples come in for the working group to consider and hopefully incorporate into the final draft of our blueprint document. And so if you're aware of organizations that are doing great work in executing the ideas that are in the blueprint, please do let us know, either through the idea portal itself or by just reaching out to either James or myself. So I think we'll do a quick check from Hannah to see if there are any remaining questions or things that we should talk about.
Yeah, it looks like we did get another question from Olivia. She's asking, can you briefly give context to how you choose who is a part of the working group and how you found or engaged with them? Mm-hmm. Seems to be many state agency leaders and nonprofits, which is great. Also curious if social justice organizations were engaged early and how often in this process.
Thank you. That's a great question. Just from a sort of structure of the Great Lakes Commission. So the commission is a group of people that are appointed through various processes in the states and provinces, generally through governors or legislative appointments to be Great Lakes commissioners. And from those commissioners, we have a subset that represent each delegation as a board member for that Great Lakes Commission delegation. So we have 10 board members, one for each of our jurisdictions. And when we're putting together work like this, our first step is to let our board know that we have a project that's going to need input from around the basin. And we ask board members for their input on who should actually sit on that working group. This one is interesting in that we have two board members, Katrina Kessler for the state of Minnesota and also Steve Galarno for Wisconsin, that are taking the time themselves to join us. So that's where these groups generally form from. And when we are looking for a diverse group like this one, we again rely on our board members to say, you know, who do you think maybe would be a right person that's coming from more the community action or advocacy community? We're really mindful that we'd like to have a very large group and have all sorts of people come to the table. But that sometimes is very hard to do, to try to put a draft up on the board. And so we started with this working group, and now at this point are really hoping that we do get that feedback from Olivia, some of the social justice and other organizations that you know, have representation all around the Great Lakes Basin that we would like to hear from. Let's see, Hannah, what else? Do we have more coming?
I just included your guys' emails in the chat box, so everyone has access to those. Olivia just made a comment, thank you. She's learning about the GLC, so it was helpful to hear all of that.
Well, and thank you. And I'll be honest with all of you that we haven't, at least in my time here on the commission staff, we haven't done this, right? To throw out a document to everyone that's connected on our Great Lakes Information Network and say, hey, do you want to come talk about this? We want to hear from you. And so we're learning. I think that, you know, the question of should we have read the document in advance is something where we in the future will do more to explain what the expectations are, maybe, for those of you that join. But I also think that, you know, just because you're on the Great Lakes Information Network and receive those listserv emails doesn't mean that you necessarily have a deep knowledge of how we function here as a Great Lakes Commission staff and the commission itself and what it does. So I really appreciate the feedback on this. And it's something where, you know, we are always looking to improve and do better with our work. And so this has all been very helpful. James, let's go on to that last slide and we will wrap things up this morning. I'll just quickly look. Yeah, we'll get everyone out of here a little bit early. So again, we're looking for those success stories. And I know it probably feels like we're being very vague in what we're looking for. But again, as you're looking at the details of this blueprint in the approaches across priority areas, across layers, and something strikes you that you think, hey, I know someone that's actually doing this and doing it really well. Let us know who that organization is. Put us in contact with them. We'd love to talk because we know that our working group and by extension, our Great Lakes commissioners are really interested in who's doing this well and how can we not only lift up their work, but also work together to replicate it across the basin. So the IDEA portal will be active until August 18th. That neatly aligns with a Great Lakes Commission board meeting. So I'll be able to report back to our board on how this went and what we've heard before working with our regional working group to take a look at all the comments that we receive, take a look at the success stories, and as they, as a group, are able to agree on how to incorporate that feedback. That's what James and I will be working on for definitely the end of August and into September. In October, the Great Lakes Commission will be convening. Great Lakes commissioners get together twice per year. We had certainly a stint during the high of the pandemic when all of our meetings were virtual, but as of their last meeting in June, they've come back to in-person meetings, and we will be bringing them to Erie, Pennsylvania, early in October. And it's my hope that the blueprint and some of the approaches and ideas that are the underpinnings are actually discussed at that commission meeting and that the document will be considered by our commissioners. What exactly that will look like in terms of how they might take action on it is still to be determined, but we'll be very pleased to be able to put this final document in their hands in October. any questions on timing or where we're going? We really do hope that that you use the IDEA portal and let us know. If you don't use it, please let us know why, because that is another case of sort of first impression for us to say, hey, can we actually use a geographic information system tool to provide this guided experience to give us comments on a document? So we're really interested overall in how that goes. We'll do one last pause to see if there are any last questions for us, but take a look at the document. We hope it's a fast read and would really love to hear from you. All right, I am not seeing any in the chat, and I'm seeing we're losing our numbers of participants. So I will thank those of you that have hung on with us to the bitter end for taking part of your day to join us and learn about our work here at the Great Lakes Commission. And if you do have questions on any of this, you've got our emails in the chat, and please do reach out. Enjoy the rest of your week.